Okay, so yeah, that's me, Javier Ramirez on Twitter, SuperEco9, in case you have any complaint of the talk or anything like that. I'm speaking about Google BigQuery, but I don't work for Google. I'm one Google developer expert, which means like sometimes I speak in places, I do community work, but I'm not in any way affected by Google, so all my opinions are mine. What I do for work is I'm one of the founders of something called Teowaki, which is a collaboration tool for software developers, and Teowaki, which is an online analytics tool. So I'm not really a small man, but I know in a conference about scalability, one of the challenges that you are going to have when you are scaling system is when your data is too big, the number one enemy when your data is too big is going to be input and output. Because if you need to read a lot of data, it's going to take time. If you have one of these fancy solid state disks, at the moment, a typical solid disk is going to transfer about 600 megabytes per second. So if you need to transfer a few, if you need to go through a few gigabytes of data, it's going to take at least a few seconds. So it's not good enough. So the kind of thing I want to tell you today is how you can use systems in which you can read a terabyte of data in 1 second. So you can have that amount of input-output power, then it's not such a huge challenge to have a big data. That's what I'm going to tell you today, how you can do that. Because the thing is, when you're speaking about big data, different people means different things by big data. So the three most accepted features of a big data thing is like, okay, if your data is moving too fast, like for example, you are trading stocks and you have to, you need to have a lot of replies in microseconds, or you are getting like a lot of information in a while, that's big data. If your data is too different, like you have data in, I don't know, Microsoft Word and spreadsheets and a database and data coming from sensors and wherever, that's also big data. And the other definition of big data is when data is too big, basically. So yeah, I'm going to be speaking about that, about the scalability when data is not too fast or not too different, just too big. So that's big data for me. If you are able to do a full scan over 300 million rows, run a regular expression, get the result in 5 seconds, that's cool. And that's what you can do with BigQuery. So why did I start working with BigQuery? Why did I start using it? My challenge was, I have this application, which is a collaboration tool, and we have a website, but also an API. And we wanted to know how users, how developers, were using the API. And we wanted to build a solution which was non-intrusive. So, you know, because I was getting data, I shouldn't be making the system going slower. I wanted to keep the history to know, you know, to be able to compare trends, how people were using the tool. I wanted to have interactive queries, like being able to ask information right now and get the information like right now. It had to be cheap because we are a two-people company bootstrapping. We have no money at all. So cheap or for free would be amazing. And if it was real time, it would be cool just for bragging, hey, it's real time, but I didn't need it. So those were the requirements. 2 years ago, when we started working with this, we didn't know much about big data, I mean, my partner and me, but we knew we will need big data for this because if you are going to be analyzing API usage, even if at first you don't have a lot of users, no, a few months after, you're going to start having like a few millions of rows. And I was in a Postgres conference last week, and a few millions of rows are not a challenge for a Postgres database, for example, or any modern database. You can easily have 50 million rows on a database and working fine. But still, you know, if you go like over that, it's going to be difficult. So, you know, we started researching a bit into big data. And back then, we had just played with a few things because, you know, you listen to things, you are a hacker, you like to, you know, try things. And the first thing is like, okay, big data, let's try Hadoop. So we tried to use Hadoop for this thing, and Hadoop is amazing, but trolling with it is you really need to think beforehand, as we just heard, what you are going to do with Hadoop. If you want to run interactive queries, like meaning, okay, I don't know exactly what I'm going to be asking, it's not the best tool because you have to be like, you know, transforming data all the time, doing different things. It's not really thought for interactive analysis. Even if there are like some tools now that make it a bit better, still it was not exactly the same. And also for Hadoop, for Hadoop to perform well, ideally you have like a cluster with different nodes. Nodes can be different, so you have to be taking care of a lot of different things. And we thought, okay, maybe Hadoop is too much for this, but maybe Cassandra, which is like really fast for inserts, could be interesting. And we took a look to Cassandra, and it's impressive. In Cassandra, basically, you can write really fast. Actually, often you can write faster than you can read, which for us was like, whoa, that's amazing. You know, it's the world upside down. And it's really cool, but traveling with Cassandra is like you basically store things, and if you want to retrieve the data for something which is not the primary key or something similar, you are not going to be that lucky. If you want to join tables, you want to do like different things, the common solution is using Hadoop to transfer the data and then using Cassandra. So again, it was like, you know, kind of complicated, and we didn't want to have like, you know, servers or things like that. Later we started reading about Spark or Storm, which are also quite cool, but you have to define your topologies, define your pipelines. Basically, you need to know what you are doing. And we thought, okay, we prefer not to know what we are doing, because yeah, because you know, we wanted something kind of fast. The analytics of our product was not really what we wanted to do for the product. It was something that we need to have, but it's like Google Analytics. If we could have something that you can just plug in and get data, that would be enough for us. And we thought, okay, what we need is analytics as a service. So we researched, and we found Amazon Redshift, which is quite impressive. It gives you, on the, you know, behind the scenes, is really a huge Postgres, which is really, really fine-tuned and with a few things. But what you get the impression you're having like big data on the backend. And on Amazon Redshift, you basically start clusters of Hadoop, you transfer data, then you get data from the Redshift. And that was cool. It was like already as a service. You didn't have to worry about, you know, having your own servers. It was everything on the cloud. But challenge is, as everything with Amazon, you pay for how much time you have the servers running. And you had to plan, okay, I want to have 3 servers, 4 servers. If I'm going to run a query right now, I'm going to load the data, run the query, and switch them off, because if not, I'm going to be paying for all the time that are running. And still, you have to be planning for how many servers do I need. I don't want to plan for that. And we discover, okay, so the thing is, we discover one thing, big data is really cool, but either you're going to have an expensive cluster, or you are going to have, you know, a hard time setting up and monitoring the machines, or it's not going to be interactive enough. And we discovered this thing, which is Google BigQuery, which for us was quite cool. BigQuery is for doing data analysis as a service. And the good thing is, you just send data, and you query data. And you don't need to know how it works. Of course, I'm going to tell you how it works, because you know this is like a technical conference. We like to know how it works, but I don't want to be worrying about that. It's good enough that I know it, and someone else is taking the pain. So that's good enough for me. So BigQuery is really amazing. Just a disclaimer here. In BigQuery, you can insert things, and you can read things. But if you want to update or delete, it's not for you. So it's thought for doing analytics. So it's, you know, you insert data and you query data. But if you have to, you know, just update, you can remove a table and create a new one with new data, whatever. But you can't update a single row or something like that. So if you need to do that, it's not for you. But we didn't have to do that. I mean, for us, we only wanted to know how people are using the API. We don't want to be tampering with history. We don't want to be removing rows or anything. So it was good enough for us. So what's BigQuery? You probably have heard about MapReduce, of course, which is one architecture that Google designed a few years ago, and they were using for many things. But in Google, they had this problem, and they found that MapReduce was not good enough for all their use cases. Specifically, if they had like, you know, big amounts of data and wanted to have like interactive queries, it was not good enough. So they designed this thing called Dremel. And Dremel is another architecture which is also defined on a paper out there, so you can read how it works. And Dremel is designed for doing interactive queries over petabytes of real-time data, which for us was good enough. I mean, we don't have petabytes of data. We don't have even terabytes of data at the moment, but still, you know, it was like quite cool. What is used for? They are using it at Google. They have been using it at Google for a lot of different things, for analyzing data from the crawler that they have on the search engine, for knowing how many applications you're downloading for the App Store, for doing log analysis, for a lot of different things. Actually, right now, they are not using it for all these things. They are changing to another internal architecture, but they are still using it for a lot of things. So you know, it's quite interesting. You can use it for many things. And one of the things in Dremel, Dremel is the internal architecture. BigQuery is basically, they thought, OK, if it's good for us for all these things, we could make like a service on top of Dremel so people from the outside could use the service. And that's BigQuery, basically. BigQuery is a RESTful API on top of the Dremel architecture. So you can be accessing kind of the same infrastructure they are using. Internally, they don't use it as a service. They start their own clusters. So you know the architecture is the same. You just use it as a service, and that's BigQuery for you. And what was the design principle behind Dremel or BigQuery? Well, it was this. When you are a data scientist, you don't want to be thinking beforehand which queries you are going to run. You are doing things, you are interactively getting data, you get a number, oh, that's cool. I would like to cross this data against, I don't know. And when you have a huge data set in different technologies, the way of working with that is like, okay, we are going to have indexes, so I don't have to go through all the data set all the time. So you know, input-output is going to be faster. Problem with indexes is you have to rebuild indexes, you have to think how you're going to query the data. If you're in Hadoop, you have to be retransforming the data. That's kind of slow, that's not interactive, and as a data scientist, you feel like really frustrated. You have to be waiting for a few minutes, a few hours, until you can run another interactive query. So they said, okay, we are not going to have indexes because everything is going to be a full scan. Like, well, I mean, all my life, when I've been working with databases, it's like full scan is the devil. You don't want to do a full scan ever, ever in your life. And they said, why not? If we could have a way of reading, let's say, a terabyte of data in 1 second, I wouldn't mind to do a full scan because it would be so fast that who cares? So, and if you don't have indexes, and if you always do a full scan, then you can do any query you want over your data because, you know, that's it. You have the data, you just run the query, it's going to work, and that's how it works. So how did they get away with this? Actually, in BigQuery, they told me they are having more than 1 terabyte of data per second of performance on Dremel internally if you are using BigQuery as a service, which is the only way that you can use it, unless you work for Google. You are going to have about 50 gigabytes per second. 50 gigabytes per second, it's good enough for a lot of use cases. Certainly, it is for me. I'll tell you later. I have a data set I can tell you later just for a scale, but 50 gigabytes is good enough. So how does it work? First thing is they use a columnar storage. If you are used to relational databases, when you have a record, like you know here, you have different rows, different columns, and each record, it's a row. And when you store this on disk, it's going to be the data from the first row is going to be adjacent in disk. So you know, you are going to store in a file the country, the product, the sales, the country, the product, the sales, once and again. And the way relational databases work, when you are reading data, you go to the index, you get the rows that you want, you get the whole row, then you do calculations on memory, and you return whatever you need to do. That's OK if you are building a web application, and you want to do something like, give me the user profile, and you get all the data from the user profile. That's amazing. For doing analytics, it's not what you want. When you are having analytics, if you have been working with data warehouses or something, you typically have tables with a lot of columns, a lot of data. And what you want to do is something like, OK, give me all the sales from this product over this period of time. So you are taking 2, 3, 4, 6 columns of data only from maybe 100 possible columns. So in data warehousing solutions and in Dremel 2, what you have is, rather than storing data in rows, you store it by columns. So you have a file storing all the information for the first column. Another storing all the information for the second column. That's here. Another for the third column. And by doing that, you can have like really good compression. Because if you have only country names in one column, it's a big change. You know, the data is going to be like repeated, so it's going to be really easy to compress. You have birth dates, you have amounts, you have whatever. You have the same type of data in one file. It's going to be really, really, really compressible, especially if you have like different strategies for compressing data depending on the type. If there are strings, I'm going to use this. If it's JSON, I'm going to use this other compression. If it's numbers, I'm going to use this other compression. As a result, in a columnar storage, you get typically between 5 and 10 times smaller files. So if input-output is your biggest problem, and you can make your biggest problem 10 times smaller, then you are 10 times faster, that's cool. So that's the first thing why Dremel is faster than other solutions. And this columnar storage has been around for a long time, and other big data solutions have it too. The other thing is they have this distributed file system, and they are quite secretive about that. It's called Colossus. And Colossus is basically a file system. Even if you have really fast disk, if you want to read, you have fast disk, you are compressing data as much as you can. Still, if you have like a terabyte of data, there is no way you're going to read it in 1 second, unless you are reading at the same time from different disk. So when you are reading a file, what you can do is, okay, I'm going to read the first, the half of the file from this disk and the other half from this other. So instead of doing like from two files, you do it from 2000 disk. And that's the thing, rather than reading a file from one disk, you read chunks of the file from 1,000 disk at the same time. You have a really, really, really fast network between the disk, and that's how you can read, you know, this amount of data in just a second. Don't try this at home. But thing is, Google can try this because, you know, they have like really fast internet network. They have a lot of disk. So basically, when you are reading a file in Dremel, in BigQuery, what you are doing is reading from in parallel from different disks at the same time. So that's the second thing why it's so fast to read from BigQuery. And the third one is when you are running the queries, they have this execution tree, which is calculated on the fly. And this is the same thing that you are, when you have a relational database, you can see the explain of the query. So it's exactly the same thing, but calculated on demand. They have metadata for your files. So when you say, okay, give me the total of sales from this quarter, from blah, 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 they look at how big are your files, how diverse they are, what's the sample of the compression, and from that, they are going to say, okay, so I'm going to run this query over 400 servers and get results back. So basically, they chunk the query into small parts to different servers. You know, if they need to do something intermediate like sorting, then they do it on the intermediate server, something like that. The thing is, your query is going to be running in parallel in different servers. Those servers are going to be reading the files which are compressed from different disks, and you're going to have the response back really fast. And it's like, it sounds interesting. Like the architecture is like, okay, sounds like cool. And the good news is if you want to start with this, since it's a service, you don't need to install anything. You just go to the Google developers, console developers, google.com. If you don't have a Google account, you need to have one. Then you just create a new project in BigQuery. You create what they call data sets and tables, the same way that in a database you have schemas. In BigQuery, you have data sets, and then you can create as many tables as you want. Data sets and tables are just a way of structuring things logically. You can query and join data sets from different, you can query tables from different data sets, even from different users. If a user gives you access to one of their data sets, you can join your tables against their tables. So it's just a way, you know, of organizing information. Nothing else. Actually, it's not a way of organizing information. It's a way of billing. I'll tell you later, you have to pay for BigQuery. But so basically, the owner of the data set is paying for that. So, you know, it's just a way of organizing. But you create data sets and tables. And tables have, like, you know, the usual data types, like strings, timestamps, numbers, also JSON. You can have, like, a few specialist types. Once you have the tables created, first thing before querying the data, you have to load the data. You can load data either JSON, if you want to have like nested fields with a structure. You can load comma separate values or tab separate values file. Or you can load directly this data from, if you have it already in the Google Cloud storage, which is like Amazon S3, you can import directly from there, or you can import using the SDK, the REST API, or even the command line tool. When you install BigQuery, the SDK, you have the command line tool, and this is for loading data. It's like, okay, just load data with this encoding, this is the format of the file, blah, blah. Once you have the data, you can already work with the data. So you go to the console online, and you're going to see something like this. It says here, select count star from whatever. This is quite familiar. You only have to go there and use SQL. So that's how you query in BigQuery. They're using SQL plus a few extensions. And when I say SQL, you can do unions, you can do joins, you can do outer joins, you can do cross joins. So, you know, you are not limited. If you are crossing 20 tables in the same query, it's going to be a bit slower than if you are crossing only two, or, you know. So the more joins you have, the slower it gets. Still, you know, you can do that without planning beforehand that you're going to join in tables. So it's quite interesting. And they give you things like, you know, analytical function, like give me the population, average, things like those. They have correlations in case you want to see if it's apparently a correlation between two series of numbers. They have window functions, which is like to run functions inside the result set again. Most databases already have window functions too, except for MySQL, but you know, you can use them. They have views, they have functions for working with JSON, a few interesting extensions for SQL, but it's just SQL. It feels like SQL when you're working with that. And you can do things like this. There is a public data sample, which are all the updates to the articles of Wikipedia for a big amount of time. And the sample has, at the moment, over 330 million rows. And we are doing, OK, give me how many articles from Wikipedia, using a regular expression, have a number, at least a number, on the title. And if you run this, you are going to be getting the count is like 200 and, well, over 200 million results. And it took 5 seconds. So, you know, it's not bad being able to run a regular expression over 300 million rows, taking 5 seconds. It will cost 30 cents, dollars, which is like nothing. In pounds, it's like, well, whatever. But, you know, yeah, exactly. But still, you know, it's like 30 cents. So you have to be careful how much data you are querying. But, you know, you can do this kind of things. That's possible. So that's quite interesting. There are other public data sets. If you want to be, like, playing with this, it's like, yeah, I would like to play with the data without, you know, having to load data first because I don't know, I don't have the data, or it's easier just to query before. For example, it's a data set, quite interesting. It's from GitHub. So they are storing there the information of the commits you are doing, pushes you are doing to repositories. And this query, what I'm doing is like, okay, from all the repositories in Ruby, and for this data range, tell me, you know, and only for the push event, give me the count of the most popular repositories, the first 100 repositories by pushes in this amount of time. And I'm getting, in 3 seconds, I'm getting the results. And it has gone in 3 seconds over 26 gigabytes of data, analyze the data, and give it back to me. That's cool. I mean, if I can have that amount of, you know, of calculation, that's really, really interesting for me. There is an even better data set, which is, the name is horrible, but it's like the Global Database of Events, Language, and Tone, which, yeah, don't ask me. And they have over 250 million rows, and it's the largest public open data set right now. Until a few months ago, you could download this data set to your laptop. It will take like about 200-something gigabytes if you download everything, the data and the graph and everything else. And a few months ago, they got an agreement with Google, so now every morning at 6 a.m., I don't know which time zones, but every day, they just download all the data from the global database of blah, 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 and Tone to BigQuery, so you can run your queries over this. And yeah, they have, at the moment, they get information from different sources of news, and also now they are getting information from Twitter, Facebook, social media. And what they are storing here is interactions things that happen in the world, like, I don't know, there is the kidnap of the girls in, I don't know, which African country, so that will be here. And also interactions between two different countries. So you can do queries like this, which is, it's a lot of SQL, but it's quite easy, actually. Which what you're seeing here is like, okay, give me the year, the name of the first country, the name of the second country, and the total of events from, okay, all the events where this country is not the same as this other. This is a really simple query. Then what you're doing here, this other thing is a window function, which is like, okay, once you have the data, give me the rank. So give me this row is the first one is the ranking for this country, the second this is the one. So what I'm getting here is, okay, with this query, I'm getting the year, country, name, and total of events, and I'm taking only the first one of every year for the last 30 years. And we can see here that, you know, in the 70s, in the 80s, Cold War, Russia and United States were like, you know, kind of not liking each other. But then it was like, you know, Middle East, and things moved to Iran, Iraq, whatever, Palestine. You know, they've been around for a while. Then suddenly it's like, again, China and United States, Russia and Ukraine. And it's like, you can go with that query over a quarter billion rows and get this data. And that's like, oh, yeah, it's cool. I like those kind of things. When they announced this data set, this public data set, a few months ago, I could see a lot of journalists trying to do like interesting things like, hey, will it be possible to predict what's happening now in Ukraine, judging from data from the past from other countries? Apparently it was, but you know, it's easy now. It's like, yeah, you have the data, you can find, you know, patterns from the past to match your data. So it's a bit, you know, not playing fair. But still, people are trying to get information from this database. Like, hey, could I predict the future? Are we repeating the past? I don't know. The thing is, it's quite cool technically. Even if you don't have such a huge data set, we are using it like for more humble things, like, okay, who is my most active user, which is something I need to know for my application, and it's quite easy to get this. Or tell me which queries I should be caching. If I have the analytics and I have, okay, give me all the queries in which I have, it's a get, and I don't have anything in the query string. If it's a get and I don't have anything in the query string, I can have here, which are like the most popular in my application, so I know where I have to be caching. That's quite easy, but you know, we're using it for these things because we can. Or we can say things like, okay, tell me the 5 most created resources in my application. I could do this. Tell me the total for each URL where the method is a post, so which are the, you know, the most created resources. Problem is, my URLs are like this. So I have, for this resource, souths, or for links, I have souths for this user, or links for this team. So even if it's the same resource, if I group a URL, I'm not going to get the data I want. But I can do something like this. I can use a regular expression to take only the last part of the URL and know for real how people are using the application, which is like quite interesting because, you know, really fast you can get data. So, you know, you can use it for some things. How other people are using this? And I'm almost there. So how other people are using BigQuery? For example, Safari books. Safari, they are running BigQuery to know which books are more popular. They have internal dashboards, so they can see which books are trending. Then they are also analyzing, you know, for the last week, last quarter, different books, even different customers, how they are using the system. So they can react over that. So, you know, that's a real use case. Khan Academy, which you usually know them. They have a lot of online courses. They are using also BigQuery now. Tell you the truth, they are starting to complain that for them it's a bit expensive now because they have a lot of data, but they are quite happy still with the product. So this is, okay, for this date, tell me how many hints people were using. So for a particular day, they were like, I don't know, 600 million hints. So probably, you know, people need help when answering the questions. So they can drill down and see, okay, which are our courses which people are asking more hints? Maybe we should, you know, redo the content. Maybe it's not good enough. I saw another company in the US, a publishing house, they do school books, electronic school books, so they can know exactly where the students are struggling to answer to the questions, or what is too easy. They can also compare by different states, different cities. And from those data, you can get really, really interesting insights. So, you know, when you have the power to store everything that's happening and then querying everything that's happening, you can do interesting things. Some other people, for example, for weather information, there is a use case that I like in one of these places where weather is really upcoming, like Minnesota, what do I know? But anyway, one of these places where the storms are really storms, not like here, like 30 seconds and stops, it's like, yeah. It's sorry about that. But the thing is, I'm from Spain, weather and other storms. The thing is, they were trying to compare, to do a correlation between the weather and the inventory. And they found out that the days before a big storm, people were going to supermarket and buying things like basic things like a lot of alcohol. So that's for real. And then, yeah, it's like, big storm, what can I buy? Yeah. And then, you know, but the days after the storm, the alcohol was not sold that well. So by crossing data between weather and what people are buying in the store, now they can predict what they are going to need. So when you want and buy alcohol, your favorite brand is going to be there because they know, you know? So this kind of thing is interesting because you have shop, you want to have that kind of power. So finding patterns in e-commerce is a good one. It's a huge one. A lot of people are starting to try and match online and offline behavior because you have a lot of information about your analytics, web trends, whatever you are using for your analytics. But you also have a lot of information from your CRM or from your call center or from other sources. And if you can cross that information, that would be interesting. So people are using systems like Hadoop or like BigQuery for feeding the information into the system and try to get information. Log analysis, actually, if you are using the Google App Engine for your application, you can do log analysis with BigQuery too. So for those things. Just the last warning, I told you before, BigQuery is not open source. It's a service, and you have to pay for that. There is not like, no, there is an open source version, which is called Apache Drill, which is from the Apache Foundation. It's like MapReduce and Hadoop. The challenge with that is you can download Apache Drill, but you can't replicate at home, like having 2,000 servers and a fast net. I mean, if you can, invite me to your home. That would be amazing to see. But the thing is, you know, but if you want, Apache Drill is there, and some people are using it, so that's it. Having said so, it's not for free, but it's kind of cheap. You pay $26, which in pounds is like peanuts, for a terabyte, and then you pay for how much data you are searching. And the first terabyte of data that you are querying every month is for free. In our case, our data set in the product is quite small. We have like about 15 million rows. And for that amount of data, we are paying less than $1 at the moment. So less than $1, not installing any servers, not having to worry about backups or anything like that, just putting the data and getting it out. I'm not a smart man, but you know, I'm quite happy with this decision. Maybe in the future, maybe if I have like, you know, petabytes of data, maybe I should find for a cheaper option. But at the moment, that's cool for me. So that's what I have. Thank you very much. Do you have any questions? I don't know if I have time.
2 minutes.
If not, I'm going to be around all day long, so just feel free to ask me. Thank you.